Good afternoon. I'm the first act of a three-ring circus this afternoon, so I'll try to move through quickly. After I finish my briefing, General Sconyers and a team of Air Force briefers will bring you up to date on a new internet service they have for young people. It's very exciting. I've used it myself, and it's about my level for the internet. And after that, Lieutenant General William Bolt, the Deputy Commander for Initial Entry Training in the Army, will talk to you about new Army physical fitness standards. Let me welcome some visitors from Latin America, the Dominican Republic, Colombia, El Salvador, Guatemala, Peru, Honduras, and Venezuela, who are here participating in a regional program focusing on human rights and democracy under the auspices of the U.S. Information Agency. I'd also like to announce that tomorrow joint evacuation, the mission that's been in North Korea looking for remains of POWs and MIAs will return some remains to South Korea. There will be a repatriation ceremony on the 24th of October, South Korean time. I don't know the exact time yet. And this is the fourth mission that has gone to North Korea to look for remains, and we have we've repatriated six sets of remains from the earlier missions. One interesting fact about this mission is that there was press coverage of it. A reporter from USA Today and also a CBS News team went along to cover parts of the mission, and also at the invitation of the North Korean government, there were representatives of veterans organizations accompanying the mission as well. As in the past, we will try to get Alan Liotta down here or somebody from POW MIA Affairs to brief you on the full mission once they return. Finally, I'd like to take note of the fact that the White House, as you know, is running a day-long conference on child care. And the one of the Pentagon representatives over there is General Major General Gil Meyer, John Meyer from the Army, who used to run the family programs for the Army. Both President Clinton and Mrs. Clinton have highlighted the military child care programs in the past. The military is the largest provider of child care services in the country, the largest single provider. And we've put out a blue top on our child care programs. One question that is not answered in that blue top today is the cost of the military child care programs. The military spends about $274 million. This is spending about $274 million this year in child care. The cost of child care to a soldier, sailor, airman, and Marine is split 50-50 between the military and the individual. So what the $274 million does is give you the military side of it, then individuals pay an equal amount, essentially, for child care services. With that, I'll take your questions on child care or anything else. Charlie.
Ken, could you discuss the miracle
laser cast, including how many bursts were actually fired at the satellite, whether you got data back from the satellite, and whether or not the test was successful?
Yeah, I'm not sure I'm going to be able to answer all your questions, but let me talk a little bit about miracle. First of all, the test did take place on October 17th during a two-minute period in the evening, and we did receive data back. We did not receive as much data as we wanted to. The people who conducted the test regard it as a partial success. They didn't get as much as they wanted, but they got something. And let me walk through some of this with you. The test, as you know, was designed to evaluate the vulnerability of our satellites to two types of laser events. One would be an inadvertent lasing of a satellite. You might ask, how could satellites be hit inadvertently by a laser beam? Hundreds of lasers are put into space in an average year for a variety of purposes, from measuring continental drift to calibrating instruments to measuring distances between objects in space. And it's possible that that one of our satellites could go into the beam of one of these inadvertently, or the beam could hit it inadvertently. So that's one of the things we were testing for. Secondly, we were testing the vulnerability of our satellites to a laser aimed at one of our satellites by somebody who might want to blind the satellite or disable it in some way. And it was done, as I said, the test was done to learn how our satellites respond to laser beams of certain powers. Now, the beam was calibrated so that it would not be done at a power level high enough to destroy the satellite or the sensors. And it was purposely ramped down so that we could test the response of the sensors to laser beams without disabling the sensors. The parts of the test that were successful were, one, we were able to locate and track the satellite at several different power levels. Two, we were able to lase the satellite or hit the satellite with laser beams that replicated both an inadvertent laser event and an intentional laser event. We were able to confirm that this happened. We were able to confirm that the power levels were correct and that they did not permanently disable the sensors. We were able to confirm that the sensors were hit, but we did not get a full response from the satellite. In other words, all the information we wanted back from the satellite. We basically had three sources of data during this test. The first was telemetry data, digital data sent back by the satellite. We got that. The second were pictures from the sensors of what was happening when it was hit by the laser. We did not get all that we wanted from that because of problems getting information back from the satellite. And third, there were some sensors on the ground that were able to give us information about the satellite. We did get information from that. So that was the information that allowed us to confirm that the beam was on the satellite and that it hit the satellite as intended.
Are we to take it then that, that the lack of information that you received didn't allow you to determine if and whether the satellite sensor had been denigrated in any way? I mean, that was the object, to determine if these laser things would denigrate the satellite sensors. You weren't attempting to destroy them, but you were attempting to show whether these things would denigrate, and it didn't tend to that.
We did not get as much visual information, that is, information back from the sensors on the satellite, as we wanted. We wanted visual information that would tell us about the effects of the laser on the sensors at high power. We did not get as much of that information back as we wanted to.
Pictures, actual pictures?
Well, we would like to see the, I think, as it was described to me, as you look into a bright light like this, if you just see sort of a white screen, that's what you would get when the laser was aimed right at the sensor, and you would get that picture back. We did not get that. So it was partially successful. We got some information. We didn't get as much as we wanted. Now, I should tell you that the results are still being analyzed, and it will take several weeks for us to complete the analysis of the results. One of the reasons we do tests, if we knew the answer to every question, we would not have to do any tests. The reason we do tests is to learn, and this was a learning experience. One of the things we learned about was something that hadn't been realized ahead of time about the functioning of the data transfer, the data transmitting machinery on the satellite, and how its buffers operate. That's one of the reasons we didn't get.
So in fact, you know that you had the satellite, which you knew before, although you hadn't tested it, you knew you could do that, but you don't know what effect it had on the sensors.
Well, that's not a fully accurate statement. We know some effects that it had on the sensor. We don't know as much as we'd hoped to learn.
Can I try another way? What did you learn about the vulnerability of the sensors, and did you learn enough to determine how to protect our satellites in the future from such laser activity?
That's the type of information we're still analyzing.
Isn't that what the test was about?
Well, as I said, the test occurred on the 17th. Today it's the 23rd. It will take us several more weeks to complete analyzing the data. So it's, I think, premature to talk about everything we've learned about this, and it's premature to talk about all the lessons we've learned from this test. That will come later. But we didn't learn as much as we'd hoped. We did learn something, and now we're trying to figure out all that we learned and what the implications of that are.
Ken, is it correct to say that the laser overwhelmed the sensor that was unable to send back the data?
No, that's not the issue.
Was it not the sensor?
The issue has to do with whether essentially the transmitters can listen and talk at the same time. And could it receive information while sending back information? And in the simplest terms, the answer is not as well as we'd hoped. Information was being sent to the satellite during the test to give it some directions. And it turns out that it could not receive and send back information at the same time. So we missed.
This is data flow, right?
This data flow.
Okay,
yeah.
So you were sending up a data message to it on the one hand, then you hit it with a laser.
And it was not able to transmit back all the information we hoped it would be able to send back.
At least partly because of the laser beam arriving at the same time. So it, in essence, did somehow mess up the ability of the satellite to function.
Was it because the laser beam arriving at the same time of the information?
It's mainly a communications transmission problem.
Which would have happened whether or not you lased it or not.
If the issue is, as I said, whether the satellite can talk and listen at the same time, and
so regardless of whether you lased it, it would have trouble talking and listening.
Well,
I'm trying to figure out what difference having it lased made to the
because
process that
it was describing. Accepting, it was getting information that we'd hoped it would be sending back immediately. It could not send back information at the same time it was receiving information. That's my understanding of the problem. It was a data transmission problem.
Is that a human error?
As I said, this is a test. If we knew how everything worked, we wouldn't have to test anything.
It would ordinarily be able to receive and transmit information.
It would ordinarily not have been receiving information at the time a test was going on.
So you're asking it to do something that under normal circumstances you wouldn't ask it to do.
So, again,
I'm trying to figure out whether or not actually lasers.
We were trying to instruct the satellite to do something improve the results of the test. At the same time we were trying to instruct it to do something, we were hoping it would be sending back information. Because of the way the satellite operated, because of the way its memory buffers operated, because of the way it communicated, it wasn't able to do both at the same time. So we weren't able to get back all the information from the satellite during the test that we'd hoped to get back.
We did not think, and
some of the information we thought might have been stored in the satellite buffer, memory buffer, was not. and it therefore was not transmitted at a later time.
How many bursts of light and of what duration?
Well, there were about half a dozen, maybe half a dozen bursts, several bursts, and none. They were all around 5 seconds.
You're saying there was no causal relationship between the laser being fired and the satellite's ability to send and receive data?
I'm saying there was a communications problem that prevented the satellite. No, that's all I'm saying. There was a communications problem that prevented the satellite from sending back the data we'd hoped to get.
But the laser didn't cause the satellite's communications problem, to your knowledge.
To my knowledge, that was not the problem.
Does the satellite retain or remain useful as an experimental tool for this type?
No, the satellite, as of today, is going into eclipse, which means that it'll gradually it will lose power. The photo cells on it will not be out of sunlight. Won't be able to recharge the batteries. So. We don't believe that this satellite will be able to be used again for a test.
There is no other target at present.
This experiment is over.
Can you explain what the telemetry data was and how
I can. Brian.
Kind of an administrative question. Earlier in the month when Secretary Cohen approved...
Actually,
the
same subject. Subject real quick.
No, it is
Wait
the same subject.
I think this is the same subject.
Okay.
That didn't sound like it.
I apologize.
That is a slow wind-up.
Secretary Cohen, you had put out a news release if he had approved the test. My question is why, given all the interest, why not put out a news release on Monday announcing that you conducted the test? I mean, it was kind of a haphazard way of telling the press corps that it happened. Or Friday or Saturday, whenever. It doesn't seem like...
I didn't learn that the test had been conducted until Monday, and I believe that we... on Monday, we did announce that the test had occurred, didn't we?
No, not
only on the query.
Well, anyway, if you asked us, we told you. Yes, John.
Does the Pentagon have intentions of continuing to develop ground-based laser weapons?
Wait a minute. This is not a question of ground-based laser weapons. This was done to test. The satellite, the vulnerability of the satellite. It was not done to develop the laser.
But is there intentions there to continue developing the miracle?
I can't answer that question. I mean, the development of the miracle wasn't an issue here. The issue was this vulnerability of the satellite.
I understand. I'm going in a different direction.
Right. I'm not prepared to go there because I don't know the answer to that question.
Did you learn anything from this experiment that could be used for offensive types of action?
That wasn't the goal of the experiment. The goal of the experiment was to test the. We are in the process of analyzing the results, and the results were designed to test the vulnerability of the satellite.
You said that the test was to test two things. One, casual accidental lasing of a satellite, probably short duration, and another, the ability of a satellite, a laser, to destroy a satellite. Well, the Pentagon already knows that if you...
I did not say that we were testing the ability of a laser to destroy the satellite.
You said it's to test the vulnerability of a satellite to intentional attack or lasing from a laser. Well,
right.
The Pentagon already knows that if it turned that laser on for 30 seconds, I guess, fired a laser, could destroy the satellite.
Well, we're testing the... I think one of the things we've learned from this particular test, since we had to try it three times before we could acquire the satellite in the laser's beam, is that sometimes acquiring the satellite isn't that easy. Yeah.
Do you have the power levels for the lasing
expansions? I don't.
About the memory buffer of the satellite in sort of relative terms to like a personal computer. How much memory does this satellite have?
I don't know. Yes, Jim. Sure.
Are there plans to send more troops to Bosnia for the parliamentary elections in the Serb areas next month?
Not that I'm aware of. Yes.
A couple of items, upcoming official visit. How concerned is the United States about China's sale of weaponry to unfriendly, possibly rogue nations, in particular advanced weaponry, and what does the United States plan to do about that during this visit, if anything?
Well, we've been carrying on an extensive dialogue with China about proliferation, and China has signed on to a number of international agreements designed to curb the proliferation of dangerous weapons. These talks with China about exports are continuing, and they will be they've been a central part of the preparation for the summit, and they will be an important element of the summit. But I think I'll let the White House talk about that when the summit begins.
More on China, please. China's ballistic missile program is also advancing. Does China possess ballistic missile technology capable of reaching the United States, and is that a concern on the part of the United States?
China has a small, long-range ballistic missile force. It would be called minuscule compared to ours in terms of numbers, or compared to Russia's in terms of numbers. You can read the size of the force in the military balance put out by the International Institute of Strategic Studies, but it's, according to them, less than 24 missiles of intercontinental ballistic range. I think in talking about anybody's military, you have to divide capability from intentions. And we see China does have some capability in the strategic missile field, but it's a rather limited capability.
Capable of reaching the continental United States.
It does have a small number of intercontinental ballistic missiles that are probably capable of reaching the United States.
A slightly more positive note on the same subject. The United States engaged or planning any military-to-military exchanges or combined exercises or anything along these lines for the near future?
Well, first of all, as you know, the Chinese Defense Minister Chu came here late last year and held meetings with then Defense Secretary Perry. At the same time, he met with then Senator Cohen, who was about to become the Secretary of Defense. And we started then a series of discussions with China on a number of issues. One, for instance, is a sort of a maritime rules of the road agreement that would help us deal with disputes involving naval ships. We've talked about exchanging port visits, and we have exchanged port visits. We've talked about exchanges of visits by high-ranking military officers, and those have occurred. General Shalikashvili went to China, for instance. Chinese officials have come here. These are being done to improve, one, communications between our senior military officials, and we think that improving communications will improve understanding and lessen the possibility of miscalculations or mistakes as we get to know each other better. We've started a dialogue with the Chinese military, and we hope that that dialogue will continue and improve. Secretary Cohen will go to China next month to continue this dialogue. One of the things we've proposed to them is much greater transparency about their military programs and intentions. We make our programs and intentions extremely public to you at the annual report, in testimony to Congress, et cetera. We've been encouraging China to do the same thing. You have to remember that China has a sharply different strategic situation than we have. It's bordered by 16 countries. And that doesn't even include Japan, which is, of course, is not directly contiguous to China. It doesn't share a land border with China. These countries, of course, range from huge countries like India and Russia, on the one hand, to much smaller countries like North Korea and Vietnam. So it has a much more complex defense challenge than we have. And certainly a much different defense challenge than we have. We would like China to be as open as possible about its intentions, about its own strategic vision, about its own military programs in dealing with its neighbors, so that the chance for miscalculation, the chance for unnecessary fears is as minimized as possible. And that is an important part of our continuing dialogue with China. We think that to the extent that this dialogue is successful, at the extent that engagement on a information level is successful, that the whole world will be safer, that we'll understand each other better.
Ken, two questions.
Sure.
Is the chair coming with Shane?
I don't know that. I think the Chinese are going to announce the details of the visit in the next day or so. It's really up for them to do that, and I think they're doing it maybe tomorrow or Saturday, but I'm not certain of the date.
Do you expect they'll reach any military-to-military agreements when the SACDEF is in China? Or do you?
I think it's premature to say that. I do think there'll be some news made on the military front during the summit, but you'll have to stay tuned.
Ken, who of the Chinese delegation will the SACDEF meet with? Do you know yet?
He'll be involved in meeting with members of the delegation, but I think that we'll have to wait for the Chinese to announce the schedule for that to be clear.
Korea?
Korea.
The in that Cochran subcommittee on Tuesday, two defectors from North Korea, Colonel Choi and Mr. Ko, testified. I think most importantly, Colonel Choi told about Kim Jong Il's strategy to inflict as many casualties on U.S. forces as possible early in an offensive on the Korean Peninsula. And he did testify that he thought that the Nodong missiles could, in fact, be ready presently for such a missile offensive against U.S. forces in Japan and South Korea. Ken, my question basically is, the committee experts say that the most advanced of the Patriot anti-missile systems cannot effectively act against to counter the Nodong. So, are the U.S. forces going to receive some protection from the THAAD or other types of more advanced anti-ballistic missiles?
Well, the THAAD is still under development, and one of the reasons we're working so aggressively to develop new theater missile defense systems is precisely to be able to counter the type of systems that North Korea has invested heavily in. We have, in the last several years, since 1994, taken a number of very important steps to bolster our forces in South Korea. One of the things we've done is to bring in a more modern version of the Patriots to improve our theater missile defense capabilities there. We've also strengthened our helicopter forces. We've strengthened our counter-battery radar. We've taken a number of other steps there. We are fully aware of, we believe, of what the North Korean military capabilities are, and we have worked very hard to develop counter forces to those capabilities.
So the Defense Department believes that there is a threat from these Nodongs that could come against U.S. forces currently? Clear and present danger?
The North Koreans aren't developing the Nodong missile for the sheer joy of developing missiles. And we're very aware of what they're doing, and we're very aware of what the threat is, and we believe we're taking prudent actions to counter those threats. We believe that that although the North Korean force is large and stationed close to the border, and although they're working on new missiles, we know that. We believe that our force is extremely potent, is extremely well trained, is extremely well equipped, and is. We hope that that neither force will be used, but we think we have a force that is very adequate to the challenge that it could possibly face in the North Korean Peninsula, on the Korean Peninsula.
Can we go back to a previous subject just very briefly?
Depends what it is.
Well, this whole thing about the laser thing. You said we know some effects it had on the sensors. What were the effects? Did it in any way blind or denigrate the sensors?
No.
At least temporarily? Or what are the effects that you know it had on the sensors?
It did. We don't believe that it disabled the sensors at these levels, but as I say, the results are still being analyzed, and we won't know the full answers to some of these questions for some time.
Ken, put it another way, after the 2 minutes of testing, was the satellite as functional, operationally functional, as it was?
I can't answer that question. I mean, we're still evaluating that information. Yes, Brian.
Just a quick one. Iraq, can you give us an update? It's pretty quiet over there. No more violations of the no-fly zone?
There have been no violations of the southern no-fly zone for over 2 weeks, and there continue to be some intermittent violations, not on a daily basis, in the north. They all occur at times when our planes are not in the box, so to speak. They seem to be calculated to take place at times when we're not in the area, and they seem to be calculated not to present a direct confrontation with our forces.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll be followed by the Air Force and then General Bolt. Thank you.
March of 95, we're averaging now about 3 million hits a week on our homepage. So without a doubt, I think the internet is certainly a way that information is getting communicated to the general populace. The emergence of the World Wide Web, however, has certainly potential for education, but there's also some concerns about access by children on the internet and the suitability of some of those materials. On July 16th of this year, President Clinton announced a strategy to make the internet family-friendly. The strategy focuses on giving parents and teachers the tools they need to prevent children from gaining access to inappropriate materials and to guide them towards high-quality educational resources. President Clinton emphasized that government, industry, parents, and teachers all have an important role in building a family-friendly internet. Well, today it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you that the Air Force is now launched Air Force Link Junior, our new website just for kids. Yesterday, in fact, 26 fourth graders from Georgian Forest Elementary School in Montgomery County helped Secretary Widnall actually launch the home page. We do have some B-roll and some still photos of that available to those of you who might be interested. We're proud of Air Force Link Junior and excited about the unlimited potential it holds for nurturing the basic learning skills of America's youth. Captain Zoom, as we call the page, offers children, parents, and teachers a fun place on the information highway that is safe, high in educational content, and dependable. The Link Junior design team set out to create a product that could encourage excitement in America's educational system. I think when you meet Captain Zoom, you'll see how excited we are about that. If I could have the video, please.
Boys and girls of all ages around the world now have an internet site available just for them, Air Force Link Junior. Online for ideas and questions about the basics of aerospace, aviation history, and more, including games. Air Force Link Junior is a safe place for children, a place parents and teachers can trust and rely on. Junior is just a click away at the U.S. Air Force homepage on the World Wide Web. To find the site, just type www.af.mil/aflinkjr. That's www.af.mil/aflinkjr. A site dedicated towards fun learning with games, planes, and more. Strap in and blast off into the newest site for kids on the web, Air Force Link Junior. I'd like to ask Captain Brian Hubbard, who headed our design teams, to come up and walk you real quickly through a demonstration of the actual homepage, and then we'll take any of your questions.
Thank you, General Sconyers. It's my pleasure to be part of Air Force Link Junior's debut, and what we'd like to do now is give you a bit more detail as to the site and what children can expect. As we bring it up, Air Force Link Junior at www.af.mil/aflinkjr. provides children an interactive, nurturing site on the internet. The first site that they'll visit after typing that address is a splash page. Parents can learn about the page, learn the objectives, learn the plugins that they need to maximize their child's experience on the web, and then let the children take off with Air Force Link Junior. After visiting the splash page, the children visit the entrance page, where the program personalizes the experience without using any cookies. From the splash page, children go to the Air Force Link Junior's homepage. The homepage introduces the children to the recurring icon of Captain Zoom, as well as the navigational and organizational structure of the site. You see, it's organized into four basic rooms. The first room is the game room. I'll pause and break from the organization for just a second to point out that along the bottom, you've probably already noticed a factoid that appears and changes every 30 seconds. Those facts give a bit of fun information for the children to learn about the Air Force. Now, the game room features four games right now. The first is the Air Force coloring book. Using shockwave technology, it's an interactive opportunity for children to color Air Force images over the internet in real time. Using the familiar paintbrush scheme, the coloring book allows children to personalize the image and choose from several. The F-22, the C-17, the UH-60, the Titan, Space Shuttle, and the B-2. In addition to the coloring book, there's the Connect the Dots, also a shockwave interface. This allows children to use sequential thinking, numerical order, and eye-hand coordination to finish an Air Force puzzle. Once the puzzle is complete, the site treats the children to a short animation. just by going back up to the Go button and then going to the media room, the children are introduced into more than just games. In the Media Lab, you have an interactive dictionary of hundreds of terms defined in both common usage and specific Air Force usage. Another feature in the Media Lab is the Air Force History. A 21-page illustrated history takes children from the Wright brothers to the modern Air Force. Another feature using real audio streamed music, the Air Force Stereo, allows children to listen to Air Force bands playing Air Force music over their computer. Streamed in stereo, it's a smart stream that will detect the speed that the children are hooked up at. Of course, an Air Force website wouldn't be complete without an airfield, and the airfield has two activities right now. The first is the flight school. The flight school uses three simple paragraphs to introduce children to the basic physics of flight. A short quiz at the end, when they complete it, will give them an Air Force video. The second activity under the airfield is a paper airplane factory that allows children to print out paper airplanes and instructions with Air Force images. We'll add to these paper airplanes monthly, but instead of just giving paper airplanes, we also give a short paragraph about what was important in the design of that paper aircraft. The last room in the Air Force Link Junior is the post office. The post office uses a special script to allow children to send personalized images to other children and tell them about the site or whatever else happens to be on their mind. In a nutshell, that's Air Force Link Junior. Its modular design allows us to expand and concentrate on new educational activities. Going to the Coming Soon room, you can see some of the activities that are planned for the future, which includes space activities, math activities, problem-solving skills, and mission planning skills. Featuring all original programming and original artwork, the first line of code was written in July, and today it's available for your children and ours. Sir?
Any questions?
I know you're hurting for pilots, but they're a little young, don't you think?
Actually, that's an important point. This was never intended to be a recruiting tool of any kind. This is what we consider sort of our social responsibility to help educate the people of the United States about what makes the Air Force work, what makes aviation flight work, and clearly it's important that our children understand that, too. I'd also like to point out that we did this in a partnership with American University, some students from American University, and most of this was designed by interns and summer hires this past summer. At about very little cost to the United States Air Force and to the taxpayer. This was all done with summer help, which was great, very talented people. Okay, thank you all very much.
there any?
Yeah, we're going to hand them out to you momentarily.
General Joe Bolt, B-O-L-T, the new Deputy Commanding General of the Army's Training and Doctrine Command. He's the Deputy Commanding General for Initial Entry Training, and he's here to discuss the new Army Physical Fitness Standards. General Bolt will make a short introductory statement, then he will have to leave. We have two experts with us as well who will remain afterwards to answer your questions. General Bolt.
I got an easy subject today. That's Army fitness, no lasers or any of that kind of stuff. So,
could you stand to your right a little bit since we have the light split so that the camera can get a better shot?
Okay. Thanks. I'm here to talk about the Army physical fitness test and revised standards that have been developed and promulgated to the field effective today. Next slide, please. You may or may not know, the Army Physical Fitness Test is a three-event test. It's a 300-point test for maximum. Minimum standard is 60 points per event for a total of 180. It involves the push-up, the sit-up, and the two-mile run. We are using the same test today that we have used since it's been developed and adopted in 1984. The Army certainly changed since that time, and the level of fitness has changed in the United States Army. But the test and the standards have not changed during that period of time. In 1992, because of the change in fitness and some other changes that were occurring in the Army, the Chief of Staff of the Army at that time directed a comprehensive study of physical fitness in the United States Army to be conducted by the Physical Fitness School. We've got two of the commandants here. Colonel Piccarello was the commander for 3 years. Of that school and was a major player during most of the study period. And Colonel Salucci, I always have trouble with the name, is the current commander of the Army Fitness School and has been doing an awful lot of the work in bringing this to fruition. Additionally, also involved in this study was Surgeon General, Army Research Institute, Army Research Institute for Environmental Medicine, plus all of the databases that are out there in the civilian world in terms of fitness. Next slide, please. Study objectives are shown here. First of all, just measure baseline fitness in the Army, see where we are. Secondly, provide a scientific review of standards for fitness. And to seek ways of rewarding equal effort in the test equally across the point system. Next slide, please. The new standards that are being laid out today really are based on soldier performance and test populations over 1994 and 1995. About 3,000 tests were administered. Across all age groups, MOSs, male, female, and those study results were tabulated in late 95 and 96. In 97, they went back out and revalidated that data based on some briefings to the leadership of the Army, and what we have today is a result of the validation of the study in 1997. We believe the standards that you're going to see are tough, challenging, realistic, but achievable. It seeks ways of providing equal effort across the rating scheme and makes PT excellence a more realistic goal across the entire force. The next chart sort of captures some of the major changes. First of all, there's been no lowering of any standards across the entire test population. But the most significant change is going to a standard for the sit-up. What the study found was that men and women have an equal mid-torso strength capacity, and so there is instead of two standards as we have had, that has gone to one standard throughout the test by age group. I think the other thing that's significant is that we see a moderately toughening of standards across all the way from minimum to maximum for career soldiers. And I think this really reflects the improvement in physical fitness that the Army has enjoyed for those age populations, both for men and women. Maximum generally get a little bit easier at the top end for push-up and sit-up populations, but generally you have to run faster to get maximum scores in the two-mile run. And it adds three new age groups, 52, the 57, and the 61-year. They figured old guys like us probably were getting a free ride and probably needed to have a little more impetus put on us. Those are the major changes. We'll have a chart up here that will show you by onesies and twosies what the changes are. For the most part, the minimums for are the numbers for the lower age categories have not changed significantly, except a significant increase in push-ups for women in those across the entire scale of scores. Next slide, please. Here's the implementation plan. A message went to the field today announcing the new standards. There is a one-year train-up period for both reserve component and ACT component soldiers, and we will. And at that point in time, all of the support materials will be distributed, and we will begin record testing first quarter of 1998. If in fact during this train-up period, no unforeseen glitches occur in those standards. Next slide. Bottom line, I think the standards that have been identified and put out by this study are tough, realistic standards and reflect probably the best, the most fit Army that we've ever had in the history of the United States Army. That's all I have and prepared. What are your questions?
Why was it necessary to change the standards?
Well, I guess the first reason I would tell you is in 1984, especially for the female data, there was very little empirical data on female performance. And so most of those standards were just extrapolated about at a 40% level from male standards. Clearly, the performance of males and females since 1994 said those standards weren't the right ones. And in fact, we have been exceeding the standards as the force has become more fit during that period of time. The other thing is it's, I think society has changed, especially in females. At 1994, we had about 30,000 females playing collegiate sports, if you can use that as some kind of measure of fitness. Today, there's 3 million involved in collegiate sports. And so the impact and the progression of women in terms of in the fitness area has dramatically increased, and these standards then reflect that increased ability of women in our society.
Quick follow-up. How much of this had to do with morale problems where men felt that they were being discriminated against?
Absolutely none. This was started in 1992. The first study results ended up in 1996, validated in 1997, and this has been a logical progression of 5 years of work to retune the physical fitness standards, total body fitness for the United States Army, with the view of maintaining good minimum standards and encouraging improvements in physical fitness throughout the Army.
How do women perform when it comes to some of the basic requirements for, say, infantry and armor, some of the MOSs that women are still excluded from?
Well, I'm not sure I can empirically tell you what that is, but what this test here measures is baseline fitness. It has nothing to do with MOS specialties, job requirements. In most cases, those are battle-focused or combat-focused skills for which commanders then build training programs to meet their requirements. For example, you will see infantry units with longer road marches with heavy rucks. You will see 4 and 5 mile runs as opposed to a 2 mile run in most of the divisions that have that. You will see different tests for entry into Ranger School and entry into Airborne School because of the physical requirements of those schools. This test does not address that. It is the baseline physical requirements to enter the United States Army and to measure fitness of the members.
It looks to me like to get maximum points, the female in both the push-ups and the sit-ups has a significantly lowered point system, or you have to do significantly less
than the male count, than the male.
In the female, sit-ups, or not sit-ups, in push-ups, and in the 2 mile run, in both of those, you do them to get your maximum points, you have much less. In other words, the current standard for a young female, 58 push-ups, the new standard is only 42. So am I reading this wrong? Or have you significantly lowered for
female? There were a lot of problems with the 1984 data. Much of the 1984 data was not appropriately set. There was a lot of mathematical extrapolation based off of men's performance. So it's like correcting it. And with women, roughly anywhere between 35 and 55% of a male strength, depending what event or type of event you're looking at, this corrected it to what it should be. And it was validated by the sample size that we had. So when you see some relaxing across the board, it's really like correcting some things that were not right. The state of the art of fitness testing, exercise physiology, the whole industry of exercise in the country has really come a long way also in the last 20 years, and testing methodologies now and databases are more refined, and I think we've been able to tap into that and scrub our things and scrub our data.
How can you say you haven't lowered the standard when you've clearly lowered
We have not lowered minimums. Some of the maximums have been relaxed to be adjusted properly. Minimums mean to pass that event, and maximums is just to super excel in it and so forth.
What is the net result? What has come out in the case of women soldiers? Is it generally tougher now, or generally easier, or about a wash, or what?
No, I think it's generally tougher and more realistic, and that's in line with the tremendous strides women have made in training and physical conditioning in the last 20 years. So it's long overdue and welcome.
For men, is it generally easier than men?
Well, it depends on which age group you are. Basically, for professional, the career force, 26 up, it becomes tougher.
Following the same trend line, do you all foresee a time ever when men and women will be held to the same standard, or will that not necessarily?
I don't believe so. In my own personal opinion, after seeing some of the data, I'm not into the testing business, but I do know that the data that I saw in capacity, women's capacity versus men's capacity, in the lower torso, it's about equal. In terms of cardiovascular, they enjoy about 85% of a male capacity, and in upper body, anywhere from 40 to 50% of capacity. So I cannot see the day where that we can, with equal effort for equal points, ever say females will be held to the same standard, say for the push-up that requires almost all upper body strength. But in lower torso, it's the case where, because physiologically, they can compete very equally.
Can you explain the row that awards 50 points, and why 50 points is awarded, and to who?
50 points is the standard for soldiers coming out of basic training. After 8 weeks, they have to achieve a 50-point standard to get out of basic training to go to advanced individual training. At the end of advanced individual training, they have to meet the Army's minimum standard at least 60 points per event. That's done so that you abate injury during that period of time, you reduce the overuse injuries, and that you provide a logical progression of soldiers coming into the Army so that they can increase their fitness over time.
Is it true? That's for recruits then, right?
That's basic training recruits, yes.
Well, if the Army is fitter overall, as you're saying, then with them being awarded the lesser points, doesn't that mean that the recruits are not as fit?
No, I don't believe that's the case at all. What I'm saying is that It has always been the case where you bring soldiers in the United States Army during the training process, you bring them to meet the Army standard. And the commitment that the training base makes to the active Army, to the Army, is that we will send you a soldier that who is deployable, who is trained, and who meets Army standards. And that's, in fact, what's done here. It's just that you don't do it at week eight, you do it incrementally so that you can reduce the attrition and can reduce the impact of overuse stress injuries on those soldiers.
At the end of basic training, then, you only have to meet the 50-point minimum, not the 60-point minimum.
At the end of basic training, you have to meet the 50-point minimum. At the end of advanced individual training, before you go to your first troop unit, you have to meet the Army standard, which is at least 60 points per vet.
That's been true, or is this a new, is this a
change?
That's
been true as long as I have been involved and as long as I know. I think that was a function of the 84 test, and that decision was made at that time.
Well, are these standards for recruits tougher in this table than they were in the old one?
In some cases, it toughens up, yes. Certainly it toughens up in terms of female sit-ups, and in some age categories and in some other categories, it does too. For example, let's take
female sit-ups.
Female sit-ups.
50 points, yes, sir. Goes up.
50 points. How many does it go up,
sir?
If you're a 17 or a 21-year-old female, you got to do 7 more sit-ups,
correct,
to get out of basic training to meet 50-point minimum. You run about the same. The push-ups are about the same, but the sit-ups are a little tougher.
Is this going to result in some of the more senior Army folks like yourself leaving the Army?
Absolutely not. We got the most senior fit guy people. As a population. I say that a little tongue-in-cheek, but as a population, the senior piece of the Army, from 26 years old, statistically, is very, very fit. And what that really says is that we are building a lifestyle in a tradition of exercise, good health, reduced smoking. I mean, the whole thing is becoming a more inculcated culture in the United States Army. And I think that population is very, very fit at this point in time.
Any indication of where civilians would measure up against these standards? I mean, was that ever a part of what you all looked at, where they would fall across the spread, just the general population, the age groups?
Well, we look at Cooper, Dr. Ken Cooper, who is America's guru on aerobics, has a lot of data on the general public, and we stack up favorably with these standards to what is fair, good, and excellent levels, respectively, of physical fitness, what he would categorize those as achievable goals.
Falls within the fair category.
Minimum.
If you don't meet these standards, what happens to you?
If you don't meet the standards, for example, you take a record PT test and fail that test. Let me go back. You have to take this test every 6 months. Or upon entry into a military, professional military school. So if you're going into an advanced course or you're going into an NCO course, you have to take this test. Those are the gates along the way. If you do not pass this test, you are given, you're counseled, given remedial training, reinforcement training. Probably a master fitness trainer will assist you in building a program to get to there. In a 90-day period of time, you have to take the test. If you flunk two of those tests in a row, you are eliminated from the United States Army.
Now, does the Army any longer have standards about how heavy you are? If you're 400 pounds and can still run the mile, the 2-mile run, and all the other stuff, is that okay?
There are still height and weight standards, and those people that exceed a height and weight standard as a screen then have to meet a body fat content. And they're measured and weighed before every PT test. So those are the hurdles also.
You could ace the PT test.
Even though you could ace the PT test, you still have to meet height and weight. I think the real reason there is cardiovascular risk go up very, very dramatically, and injuries go up very dramatically over height and weight requirements, and so you become less you become a greater risk at that point.
How many go each year, would you say, because they don't pass these tests or don't meet the standards?
I don't have that data.
It's less than 3% on the APFT. I'm not sure on the body fat. But the other thing, sir, to clarify on the height weight, even if you're above the height weight standard, you are then put into a body composition or body fat measurement. And you see a lot of very muscular, heavily trained people, very fit, that still pass and all systems are go, and as you mentioned, would do very well on the PT test. So we're looking more in terms of people at risk of obesity. But if you're dense, muscular, dense, and fit,
and they have the tape. Okay. They have the tape tests that measure body fat.
Can you explain physiologically why it is that women are capable of doing as many sit-ups as men?
We have a lower center. We tend to have a lower center of gravity, specifically meaning our belly buttons are placed lower on the abdomen, and you just have an easier sense of balance and able to get the repetitions going. And even an untrained state can probably do a lot of sit-ups. So that has been taken into account. The data showed that we match the men almost rep for rep in the sit-up category. And this is a good thing. This is the first time ever we've had a purely gender equal event. Everybody does the same to the male's standards, to the men's standards on the sit-up. It's just a little easier for us to do that.
You already mentioned that the minimum standards are not being relaxed at all, but some of the maximums are changing pretty radically. For a 42-year-old man, for example, they had a minute cut off the time they need to get 100 points. Well, a 17-year-old woman has more than half a minute more now.
The maximums were set mathematically. Let me show you real quick.
On the old test.
If you just add 40 repetitions or 40 points above 60, you get 58. 40 points above 16, you get 56. And all the way across the board for sit-ups and push-ups, and then a 40 seconds faster or 6 seconds faster. So that was done mathematically. That was not based on the performance of the 84 test group. The current performance, 94-95 data, is based on the bar that was set is what realistically was performed.
So the 84 standards are somewhat arbitrary then?
Yes. Yes.
For both the sexes? Because the man has dropped too.
Yeah, even in the older age groups of the males, wouldn't you extrapolate it out across?
In 84, there was very, very little, especially in the older age groups. At one point in time, the Army did not even require physical fitness tests of personnel over 40 years old. When I came in the Army in the 60s and early 70s, and then I went to 45, as I recall, and then we have increased the requirements for the more elder population to be measured for fitness, just like everybody else. And so a lot of those scores became skewed just because there wasn't any data in 84 to base realistic numbers against.
Especially for young people, it looks to me in both sexes that you have lowered the standards significantly for the maxes on young people, both genders. Why?
Well, we were requiring the young guys to max that 2-mile run at the 99th percentile with that 11:54 2-mile run time, when everybody else only had to max at the 90th. So that's a lot of difference. It was some things that just were not right, and they're now being corrected. So when you see those relaxings, it's usually due to some error rate from before.
So the argument you would make is that the empirical data that you based it on before was arbitrary and not based on much of anything.
For the maximums, that's correct.
For the maximums. That's correct. And today, although it would look to me as a layman like you have dropped your top standard significantly, you would argue that now you're basing it on some sort of real data.
Yes.
As opposed to
current
some general saying, let's have you do it at 90 push-ups or whatever.
Based on the current performance of the force, 94-95
then. Frankly, we're talking about right now 6% being able to get into a band that we call physical training excellence. And that's 290 and above. 290 and above. And what we perceive right now is that this was pegged the maximums was able to be able to probably call in about 10% of that population into a band of called PT Excellence. There's also a thing called extended scales and all those kind of things. We get people that blow these numbers completely off the chart. But in terms of badge awards and recognition of excellence, we think that number will be about 10% of the force.
6%, 290 and above before, and 10% now? Is that what you said?
No, no.
We predict.
Yeah.
But they're more fit totally. They have to be, to get the badge now, they must have a consistently high level of upper body and aerobic and mid-torso, everything, where before just a total score was considered. It didn't matter if you were deficient in one of the events. Now you must be excellent in all three events. So I think
you have to achieve 90 points in each event, which is now a total fitness, whereas before you could piece from one, maybe let's say 82
100,
points.
170.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah,
right.
Kind of.
You could be marginal in one event. Maybe still get
it still looks to me like you're letting more people into the tent. If you're going to have 10% as opposed to 6% in that top bracket, you're sort of
are you saying that those people aren't fit? I mean, the issue is that we're. I mean, as a commander, I'm really concerned about moving the 60 points up into the higher levels. At the top level, what we're doing is rewarding hard work and excellence. I don't think that that is the concern in terms of combat readiness and fitness levels as trying to deal strictly with minimums. I think that's really where the major issues of the Army is.
How does the Army compare with the other services on these tests?
Are you totally different?
The tests are a little bit different. I think you guys
The Marines do. As far as fitness testing, which is different than combat specialty testing, fitness testing, the Marines have the sit-ups. They have, I think it's a 3-mile run, and they have, instead of the push-ups that we have, they have the flexed arm hang for the women, and they have the either the chin-ups or the pull-ups for the men. It's still, again, you have the different age groups, and you have the different, but different only in that aspect. And the Navy also has, again, the push-ups, sit-ups, and that type of thing. So they're relatively close.
We got time for one more question.
In any of your research, did you see how America's Army stacks up with other world's armies, other NATO armies, for example?
I don't know if we've done any empirical data on that. I've seen those armies. I've been around them. I think we stack up extremely well. I don't say that. I mean, if you just look at content of smokers as a measure of fitness, I'm not sure that an awful lot of armies have weight control programs like American Army. So I think we stack up extremely well. And I think one of the things you need to keep in mind as we go through here is that America's Army is very, very fit. It went to the desert and performed very, very well in a very, very tough environment. It's been around the world. Fitness of the Army when it's committed has not been an issue that I can remember since the days of Grenada when we brought kids out of Fort Bragg, North Carolina, in the middle of the wintertime in an ice storm, and they were humping 155 and 155 ammunition shells, and there was talk of how strenuous that was. That was a heat issue more than a fitness issue. So I think the United States Army has performed very well physically fit. And I think the study really says is that since 1994, the bar has actually gone up in terms of overall what is actually the fitness levels and where soldiers actually fall in being able to meet these standards across the board.
Thank you all very much. Appreciate it.